Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all so much for joining us today, or good morning, depending on where you're calling us from. My name is Katrina Forrest, and I'm one of the co-executive directors of CityHealth, and you all are in for a real treat today because we have a wonderful panel later in today's program featuring our esteemed guests from Portland, Oregon, and Columbus, Ohio. But before we get started, I do just want to provide a brief overview of who we are at CityHealth and why we've prioritized green space as a policy intervention. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with CityHealth, we are an initiative of the de Beaumont Foundation and Kaiser Permanente, and we've developed and we advance a package of pragmatic yet aspirational policies that have the potential to help all city residents live healthier and more full lives. Each year, we evaluate the nation's largest 75 cities based on the number and strength of the policies from within our package that they have adopted. And we award those cities gold, silver, or bronze medals that we release in our annual report. At CityHealth, we know that our health outcomes are shaped by where we live, where we work, where we play, and where we learn. And we understand that the improvement of these conditions is our imperative. And it's the reason that CityHealth approaches its work with an emphasis on prevention. Our goal is to try to stop health problems before they start. And we believe that city leaders can really lay the groundwork for better health outcomes for their residents by investing in prevention-focused policies like those that you'll see on the next slide. Now, this slide highlights our current 12 policies. And in the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of these, but should you have any questions, please feel free to drop them into the chat. As you can see, our package includes policies focused on housing affordability, renter protections, tobacco cessation, street design, and of course, green space. Next slide, please. Now, in my mind, our partnerships are truly what makes CityHealth rich and unique, and we are fortunate to work alongside some nationally recognized subject matter experts and advocacy organizations in each of our 12 policies. These partners are not only instrumental in helping us design our specific policy criteria, but they also provide technical assistance to our cities. Our partners truly are the engine that makes CityHealth go, and we are incredibly grateful for their knowledge, their expertise, and the connections that they bring to this work. And I would absolutely be remiss if I did not give a very special shout out to the Trust for Public Land. They are our collaborator and co-conspirator, not only for today's webinar, but in all of our green space work. And we truly could not do this work without them. So why green space? Shakespeare once said, "One touch of nature makes the whole world kin." It's a quote that I think beautifully underscores how interconnected we all are and the power of nature and green space to serve as the connective tissue that brings us all together. We all shoulder the responsibility of protecting, preserving, and expanding our natural spaces. And when we do so collectively, we realize myriad health and environmental benefits. When I think of contacts with nature and green space, I am reminded of being a child and putting my hands in the dirt to plant flowers and vegetables with my grandmother. I also think about admiring the tree-lined streets in my own neighborhood and barbecuing and picnicking with friends and family in the verdant local parks within my community. And I reflect on all of these experiences fondly. But unfortunately, too many people, and especially people of color, are unable to enjoy these moments, because while green spaces are an integral component of urban environments, all too often they are inaccessible and inequitably distributed, leaving millions of residents without available spaces to frequent, use, and enjoy. Research suggests that proximity to parks and green space is correlated with greater levels of physical activity, improved mental and physical health, and positive impacts on environmentally related health outcomes on things like air pollution, stormwater absorption, and heat exposure. But disinvestments in these spaces across neighborhoods and communities leads to critical disparities. And it is for this very reason that CityHealth, in partnership with TPL, has been intentional in how we've structured our policy criteria. So as you can see here on this slide, to earn a bronze medal from CityHealth, cities must adopt or ratify a policy that either achieves 100% park access within a 10-minute walk for all residents by 2040, or increases tree canopy coverage within a specific time frame and with a measurable goal. To earn silver, of course, the city must meet the bronze criteria, but then they must ensure that they are directing their resources appropriately to support the policy. So specifically for CityHealth, we are checking to ensure that city's public spending on parks and green space is at or above $66 per capita, which is the national median. Finally, in order to earn a gold medal, cities have to both meet the bronze and silver criteria, but also clearly prioritize underserved and disinvested neighborhoods based on both racial and economic equity, as well as data-driven park need. For us, it's not enough for cities to commit to green space through policy, but we want to ensure that those who have been most marginalized and left behind are prioritized. We also want to make sure that funding and spending follows the stated policy commitment. There is a significant and urgent opportunity for local action to chart a new, greener, and healthier future for all, and equity absolutely must be central to this work. Now, last week, CityHealth and TPL released a comprehensive report on green space, which you can access on our website at cityhealth.org. The report dives deep into the evidence, it provides case study examples, and it further breaks down the criteria I just explained. Now, I have touched very much on the surface on some of the myriad health benefits associated with green space, but I'm actually going to turn it over to Howard Frumkin, who is an international leader in health. And he serves as Trust for Public Lands Senior Vice President, where he directs the Land and People Lab. He'll go much deeper on the compelling research that informed our report, and he'll also talk more about the critical importance of policy. So with that, Howie, take it away.
Thank you very much, Katrina. I'm going to take a minute to share screen now, and I'll do the usual thing and ask you to confirm to me that you're seeing the right thing. You seeing that?
Nothing yet, Howie.
All right, keep working on it. This always goes so much better in the practice session than it does in real life. Sorry about this. Let's see. Screen one, share. How's that?
Perfect.
All right. Well, greetings, everybody, from Bainbridge Island, Washington. Happy, happy summer solstice day. Happy longest day of the year. We'll try to make this hour the shortest, most exciting hour of the longest day of the year for you, by sharing with you some great information about the health benefits of parks and green space. First, just to introduce TPL briefly, for those who don't know us, we're a national nonprofit that works to create parks and protect land for people, ensuring healthy, livable, and equitable communities for generations to come. We are driven by four strategic commitments that you see here. One of them is health, and of course, that's the link with CityHealth. But community, equity, and climate are equally important to us, and those, of course, are indirect drivers of health as well. We advance these strategic commitments through the four kinds of projects that you see here: parks, schoolyards, trails, and lands. And over the 50 years that we've been working, we've accomplished a lot. I won't inflict on you the reading of this slide, but lots of projects completed, lots of land protected, lots of people who've gained access to parks through our work, and overall a record that we're very proud of. We've been pleased to partner with CityHealth since 2021, as you just heard. We've supported the development of the Greenspace Policy Package that you just learned about, and we work to assess how those policies are being implemented in CityHealth's 75 cities. In the 2022 policy assessment, 20 cities have received gold, 13 silver, and 14 bronze for their green space policies. And the cities that have received these medals span all geographies, populations, and political affiliations. We're really excited to continue to support cities as they work to advance policy solutions that promote health through equitable access to parks, trees, and green space. And I'm about to tell you why we're so excited. Because parks and green space are really good for health. They advance health through the pathways shown here, and I'm going to run through these and explain a little bit about each one to you. And I'm going to emphasize as I do that these are not just rhetorical claims. Every one of these pathways is backed up by very solid evidence. So first, let's talk about nature contact. Nature contact in and of itself is really good for health. In terms of mental and behavioral health, nature contact reduces stress, depression, anxiety, even ADHD symptoms. It leads to more pro-social behavior among children and reduced aggression. And just to give you a taste of the kind of science that backs up those claims, here are a few recently published research papers documenting fewer depressive and burnout symptoms, less emotional distress during the COVID pandemic, lower sales of mood and anxiety disorder medications, less postpartum depression, lower suicide rates, all in relation to having parks and green space near where people live. But that's just the mental and behavioral health benefits of nature contact. Those may be intuitive. A little less intuitive may be that nature contact directly delivers these benefits you see here: lower blood pressure, smoother post-op recovery if you can see nature out the window of your hospital room, better birth outcomes, improved pain control, less obesity, less diabetes, even better eyesight. The asthma goes both ways, because if you happen to be near trees that generate a lot of pollen, the effect on your asthma may be bad. But otherwise, depending on the kinds of trees, the effect may be good. Recent evidence just continues to document less cardiovascular disease in greener neighborhoods, lower diabetes mortality, less preterm birth, fewer premenstrual symptoms. This is the first time we've seen this kind of data, and lower COVID mortality. And in terms of overall health and well-being, nature contact makes you sleep better, improves health in cancer patients, better general health, healthier child development, longer life expectancy, greater happiness, which is a predictor of health. And we've had recent evidence building up some of these conclusions too. More outdoor free play among children, fewer somatic symptoms, and greater subjective well-being. So very powerful impacts from the contact with nature. Why do we care about this? Because parks and green space are where nature contact happens. It can happen through relatively passive and sedentary activities, simply exploring nature as these children are doing, or sitting in natural settings, or it can happen through active recreation in nature, cycling, walking, jogging, paddling. And that leads to the second pathway through which parks and green space improve health, and that is through physical activity. Physical activity is remarkably good for health. These are some graphics from the CDC. The one on the left for adults, the one on the right for children. And there's almost too many benefits here to run through, from brain health to heart health to cancer prevention, you name it. Physical activity is great for health. And parks and green space are a setting for physical activity. But it's not enough just to provide the park or the trail or the open space. People need to have access to it. Given access, they need to go there. Once they're there, it really helps if the right facilities, such as playing fields and paths, are in place, and the right amenities like shade. Programming helps a lot. So if you've got sports programming or sports classes, yoga classes, and so on, that helps people be more physically active in parks. So does good maintenance. People don't like going to squalid or dirty parks for their physical activity. All of this will have policy implications, as we'll see in just a minute. A third pathway to health is social connections. We have a problem in our country with loneliness. I won't flog you with numbers on this. You can read the Surgeon General's report from a couple of weeks ago to learn about the toxic effects of loneliness and social isolation. Conversely, we know that social connections are really good for health. People who have good networks of friends, family, and neighborhood connections live longer lives, have less cardiovascular disease. If they're elderly, they're less frail. They have lower risk of respiratory infections, less dementia, lots of benefits from social connections. And parks and green space function as a setting for social connections. We have lots of evidence, as you see here, from recently published papers. And some of the same factors that promote those social connections in parks are the same ones that promote physical activity. You have to have access. You have to go there. You have to be attracted to stay longer than shorter, because longer visits predict more social connections in parks. Good amenities, good programming, and good maintenance as well. Not only that, on the interpersonal level, but parks and green space can help bridge social divides. We know that intergroup contact, contact between native-born Americans and immigrants, contacts between people of different religious backgrounds, different racial backgrounds, those things can happen in parks in very positive ways. And what encourages them is if there is a sense of welcome and belonging, if there is a sense of engagement and inclusion, if different groups feel like they actually are part of the park, if they see representation of their own identities in the park, and if they have, again, a sense of ownership. So parks provide social connectivity in that intergroup sense, as well as the interpersonal sense. A fourth pathway is happiness. Now, we have a problem in our country. Happiness is declining. The blue is the number of people who are very happy. The brown is the number of people who are not too happy. And we're going in the wrong direction there, tragically, not only for adults, but for children as well. Happiness is dropping in this country. And that means that parks are an opportunity, because parks make people happier. Lots of evidence that happy sentiments matter for health, and that happy sentiments blossom when people are in parks and in the presence of green space. So happiness as a pathway to health, one of the important pathways for parks. Safety is another pathway through which parks and green space deliver health and well-being. There's a lot of evidence that you see here showing that greater tree canopy is associated with less violence, less property crime. And we have this evidence from city after city. There's been suspicion over time that trees may actually be places for predators to lurk and hide, but the evidence doesn't bear that out. In fact, parks and green space strengthen communities and tend to be associated with reduced crime and improved safety. The next pathway is noise reduction. Cities are noisy places, but parks and green space offer quiet. Not only that, they offer a replacement of traffic noise with natural noises such as bird song. Noise is bad for health. It increases stress. It increases cardiovascular risk. And parks offer a partial antidote to that problem. Next pathway, climate resilience. Parks and green space offer climate resilience in several ways. They cool neighborhoods off. Here's a picture. It's a heat map of New York City. And if you look at this, you'll see that Central Park and Prospect Park, all of the big parks have around them a several block wide area of cooler temperatures. Parks are not only cooler places than the surrounding neighborhoods, but the neighborhoods themselves get cooled down. Parks also manage stormwater well, helping to avoid flooding in nearby neighborhoods, as exemplified by the Rodney Cook Senior Park here in Atlanta. And the last pathway I'll mention is air quality. Parks and green space and trees can improve air quality in significant ways, and that in turn is a pathway to health. So, eight different pathways, many, many ways, each of them based in evidence through which parks can improve health and well-being. Now, there is an important element to all of this, and that is the question of equity. We know that, as Katrina said earlier, not everybody has equal access to parks and green space. We've got a lot of documentation. We've done some of this work at TPL, and academic experts have done some of this work. You can see some headlines here from recently published studies. Some of the disparities directly reflect historical redlining, indicating that these disparities have deep historical origins. This is a graph of tree cover and income in the 100 largest U.S. urbanized areas. And you can see not only that race, ethnicity are predictors of having less access to good parks and green space, but so is poverty. Wealthier communities along the x-axis have more tree cover along the y-axis. Now, there's a second important element of the equity story, and that is that just to point out that the equity issues arise in city after city. This is a picture of Los Angeles showing deep red need for parks in contrast to areas that are well endowed with parks. The second important element of the equity story is called the equigenic effect. This is a graph of the relationship between green space access and mortality. And this is the wealthiest group that was studied. This is the next poorest group. This is middle class people. And you can see that mortality is higher. And mortality also decreases as you go to greener neighborhoods. And this is the poorest group. And you can see that shamefully poor people have higher mortality than everybody else. But still, the greener the neighborhood, the lower the mortality. And what I want to point out to you is that the disparity in mortality between the wealthy and the poor, which is quite high in the less green neighborhoods, is reduced in the greener neighborhoods. So some of that health disparity is reduced by green space. This is called the equigenic effect. In public health terms, we get much more bang for our buck by providing green space to the neighborhoods that lack it, because that's where the mortality differentials are the highest. And the last feature to mention in equity, of course, is the possibility of green gentrification, exemplified by New York City's High Line here. We really have to pay attention to preventing or minimizing the displacement that comes from gentrification as we create parks and green space. We've got policies that help us do that. And that's an important element of the mandate to create more park and green space equity. And finally, let me settle on policies that help advance park and tree equity. These are policies that are part of the City Health package. We promote park access, which I told you is important to achieving health goals, by being sure that people live near where parks are and that parks are near where people are. These are the 10-minute walk goals that are part of the City Health policy package. We want to expand tree canopy by having citywide tree canopy goals. We want to promote the use of parks by having ample budgets so that parks can be maintained, can have adequate programming, can have adequate amenities. That gets people into parks and that delivers the health benefits. And finally, promoting park and tree equity by identifying, measuring, and rectifying inequities, pinpointing the neighborhoods that need more parks and trees, and prioritizing those neighborhoods for investment. So to summarize, parks and green space are a public health superpower, delivering health through the many pathways that I mentioned. Equity has to be central to health promotion through parks and green space, and a wide range of policies can advance these goals. Well, with this, I want to pass the mic to Catherine Patterson, who will lead what I know will be a fascinating discussion featuring the cities of Columbus and Portland. Now, I did a little bit of homework. I learned that there are 23 cities and towns in the U.S. named Columbus, from Georgia to New York to Montana, and there are 22 Portlands, from Maine to Oregon to Texas. So I should be specific. We're talking about Columbus and Portland and the great states of Ohio and Oregon, respectively. Catherine, who will moderate our discussion, is co-executive director of City Health. Prior to joining City Health, she served as the managing director for urban health and policy at the de Beaumont Foundation. And before that, at Pew Charitable Trust, she led campaigns to improve children's dental health across the country. Thank you for moderating this discussion, Catherine. Over to you.
Howie, thank you so much for that kind introduction. And I really appreciated your underscoring the importance of green space and the unbelievable benefits that we can accrue from having access to green space. I just want to remind folks who are joining us today, if you have a question, please submit it through the Q&A function. We'd love to see your engagement, love to see your questions, and we'll try and incorporate those. So I have the great fortune of introducing our panelists today. We have Anita Clark, who is the Assistant Health Commissioner of the Columbus Public Health Department. Anita was appointed Assistant Health Commissioner for Administration at Columbus Public Health in 2020. In her role, Clark oversees the department's administrative services and neighborhood social service divisions. Clark has 26 years of experience working at Columbus Public Health. And prior to her appointment as Assistant Health Commissioner, she served as the department's fiscal manager. I think it's also fascinating to note, and I know Anita will talk a little bit about that, prior to joining Columbus Public Health, she served as a social worker. Next, we have Todd Lofgren. Todd is the Deputy Director of Portland Parks and Recreation in Portland, Oregon. Todd has over 20 years of experience leading diverse teams to develop and implement high-yield operational and funding strategies to empower underserved communities. And we're going to hear a lot about that today, and I'm really excited on focusing around that. Todd has local, national, and international political experience, including leading policy and management strategies to support the vision of elected and senior government officials. Welcome, Todd. Welcome, Anita. And Howie, if you, oh, perfect, wonderful. Thank you so much. So I'd love to start our conversation today just talking a little bit about your different vantage points. You know, just thinking about your bios, you all are coming from very different perspectives. So I'd love to start with you, Anita, and just hear a little bit more about your organization's priorities and how parks and green space fit in to those priorities.
Well, certainly, and thank you, Catherine. I do want to point out, Howie, I just loved your statement that green space is a superpower for public health, and I so much agree to that. And so I'll just jump right in. Green spaces and parks are vital to the physical and mental health of our residents. It's an important public health focus as we work to improve the overall health of our community. Green spaces and parks give residents the opportunity to be physically active and connect with families and neighbors. And being physically active, even for short periods of time, means so much with the health benefits, as Howie shared. Green spaces are also available, you know, provide opportunities for residents and the entire neighborhoods to build community gardens. These gardens remove barriers by providing fresh produce close to home, and they can be economic drivers for people who live in the neighborhoods. The bottom line is spending time outside and expanding access to green space and parks are essential to providing better health outcomes, especially for at-risk and marginalized communities. They also help address many of the social determinants of health, including food access, safe neighborhoods, and physical activity to address chronic conditions like obesity and diabetes. We are proud to live in and work in a city where our leaders get it, and that is so important. For example, Columbus City Council has adopted or ratified a policy or formalized planning goal either to achieve 100% park access within a 10-minute walk for all residents by 2040, or to increase tree canopy coverage. These goals clearly prioritize underserved and disinvested neighborhoods based on racial and economic equity and data-driven park needs. Additionally, Columbus public spending on parks and green space is at or above the national median per capita, and the city maintains the level of spending within $10. And the Columbus Urban Forestry Mastery Plan is a strategic long-term investment in Columbus's tree canopy. Trees reduce urban heat island effects, improve air quality and public health, reduce water pollution, moderate climate change stressors, and much more. This sustainable and equitable tree canopy will appropriately place to provide other environmental and social benefits in neighborhoods. Green spaces help improve public health by cleaning our air, shading our streets and homes, and creating welcoming community spaces that promote good physical and mental health. And they will help us address the social determinants of health so all people in our community can live the healthy and safe lives they all deserve. So thank you for that opportunity to expand on that.
Anita, I so appreciate you bringing in the social determinants of health, really thinking about all of those drivers of good health and unfortunately sometimes poor health outcomes. And we're going to talk more about that during our conversation. Todd, I'd like to turn the conversation back to you and the similar question, just sharing a little bit about the perspective from the Parks Department and particularly how you think about planning and equity and the role of planning and equity around parks in your community.
Thanks, Catherine. Thanks, Howie. Great to be here today. Really appreciate CityHealth and Trust for Public Land bringing us all together today. I'll share a little bit what's happening in Portland, Oregon. we're proud at Portland Parks and Recreation, the City of Portland's made a commitment to have all Portlanders live within a half mile of a park or natural area. So that's something that we've been working on since 2000. We made that commitment and we renewed that commitment in 2020. We also prioritize the urban forest as really essential to kind of the health and well-being of our neighbors. And I can talk more about that in detail this morning. But we're morning on the West Coast, afternoon for those of you around the country. And so we have a goal there of 33% canopy coverage, but it's not equally covered across the city. So that's something we're really working on as well. And we can talk more about that. But we see our mission at Portland Parks and Recreation to provide equitable access to welcoming places, programs, and services that improve community health and our environment in Portland. And we envision a parks and recreation system that's responsive to the diverse and changing community needs, nurturing health and connection for all Portlanders. And we have something what we call the Healthy Parks, Healthy Portland planning effort. It's an ongoing iterative planning effort that we're always listening and learning from our communities in Portland. And so we're looking at ways where we can create public spaces. And what we've heard so far is really Portlanders want safe, accessible, and welcoming places, but for everybody. We know the parks and recreation systems connect people to the places, but also to each other. And partnerships has been a big part of how we've been able to do that here in Portland. And recently, one of our new commitments as part of our Healthy Parks, Healthy Portland planning process is we made an equity and anti-racism commitment to acknowledge and abolish the harms of racism and oppression in our parks and recreation system. We're taking accountability for our history of racism in Portland and the unequal treatment of people, both community members and our employees. And so we're really centering people that have been most impacted by those inequities historically. So I look forward to our conversation this morning. Thanks.
Just your brief overview of how you all are thinking about parks, both from an anti-racist lens and also from hearing, right, from your community members. What do they need? What are they looking for? From the Parks and Recreation Department, I would love for you to share a little bit with us about how Portland is thinking about parks and green spaces as public health assets. You talked a little bit about that, but would love to learn a little bit more about how you're also trying to link that back to health outcomes. Oh, Todd, you are on mute, my friend.
Sorry, thought I clicked that. So we know from the listening and learning that we've done in Portland that what they like most about Portland, regardless of race, age, or how long they've lived here, is access to the outdoors and natural areas. So we've known that from the outreach that we've done. We also know that there's health disparities in our community, and those health disparities are oftentimes in geographic areas like how we just described, about where there's lower canopy coverage and lower park access. And so we've been focusing our investments both for the urban forest tree canopy and also for our parks and natural areas in areas that have higher racial diversity, in areas that have lower income and have higher concentration of youth. So we think that's kind of an investment into our future, if you will, here in Portland. And so that's been really important about how we look about growing the park system. On the programming side, we also have looked at how we reduce costs as a barrier. Historically, we've been dependent on program fees for maybe programs that we've offered in the past. So we've really expanded our free programming, but also created an access pass so Portlanders can get up to a 90% discount for low-income Portlanders that couldn't normally be able to afford some of our programs. So those are some of the ways that people that we think that those physical fitness programs, whether they're outdoor in a park or our summer camps, other learning how to swim in our pools, are all ways to provide more access. but also the kind of public health crisis around hunger in our community. So a lot of kids in Portland get access to their free meals, whether it's breakfast, lunch, and sometimes after school. When school closes, those access to food programs go away. So that's where Portland Parks and Recreation kind of fills in that gap. We go across 50 locations across the whole city where we have mobile lunch and play programs where there's lack of access to parks, but also we have a lunch and play program in our parks where we're providing free meals to kids and play opportunities that are facilitated by a lot of our young people here in Portland that are high school students or college students that come back for a summer job. And then a last example I'll just use is about the heat island effect around lack of tree canopy. So sadly, about 2 years ago, we had a heat dome here in Portland. 71 people died in Multnomah County. And the hottest places in Portland are the low canopy neighborhoods. And those are also overlapping with our lower income, more diverse neighborhoods. So disproportionately, lower income Portlanders and diverse Portlanders are affecting those problems from the lack of tree canopy. So just give you an example of how that plays out in Portland. About 56% of our tree canopy on the west side of our Willamette River, where about 20% of the population live. But then when you go east of the Willamette River, where 80% of the population lives, it's about 21%. So we're planting trees, trying to create tree canopy policies to preserve existing large form trees. And that's a lot of the work that we're doing right now. One little factoid I'll share is like on a hot summer afternoon in Portland, if you're on the west side of the river or on the east side of the river, it's 15 degrees hotter than it is on the west side of the river. So it's really makes a difference for people's livelihoods.
Yeah, I truly appreciate really calling out directing resources where both the need is greatest and also really looking at underserved communities. And Manta, just thinking about 71 deaths because of the heat dome effect. I'm really just focusing on the effort of the Parks Department, as you said earlier, investing in the future, planting trees, making sure those interventions are being done now, maintaining them, also the older growth, more mature trees, just so not only strategic, but also thinking about that long-term health impact. I'm also really struck by your, I think you called them the lunch and play programs, meeting kids where they are, which is in play spaces, and then also addressing that need around food access. Really appreciate those really clear examples. Anita, I'm going to move to you. I would love to hear you talk a little bit about how you think about your role in jointly promoting parks, green space, and health from your position in the health department.
Thank you. We have such a wonderful relationship with our Rec and Parks program here and are constantly working together to come up with strategies to improve green space and the mental health of our community. And recently we were on a leadership meeting and we have a program called One Block at a Time. And it's really a focus on building resiliency up in one block. And we discussed with Rec and Parks, you know, they have a canopy program and they're going to join us at the table on our next block that we do and also go out on the current block and really assess what kind of trees are needed out in that community. So the partnership is there. And I do want to point out that, you know, earlier in the year, and I'm sure most of you know this, the U.S. Surgeon General's advisory on healing effects of social connection and community published an advisory, you know, bringing attention to that loneliness and isolation, which we know just really exploded after COVID and isolation and quarantine. So it's important that, you know, individuals have green spaces to go to for their own mental health. And something else that's significant, research shows that the mortality impact of being socially disconnected is similar to that's caused by smoking up to 15 cigarettes a day, even greater than that associated with obesity and physical inactivity. And I think that says something. The advisory highlights that parks are a key piece of social infrastructure And so our relationship with our partners with the Rec and Parks is so important here at the city. We have, you know, safe green spaces and parks for people to gather to exercise in the community. And these benefits translate all to work that we're doing in public health. And we really want to look at it with a health equity lens and really go into the neighborhoods that don't have the green spaces and provide the parks and the green spaces for those entities in those neighborhoods.
Anita, I really appreciate you calling out parks as infrastructure and thinking about them as part of the social fabric, also directing resources where historically they have not been invested, particularly as it relates to tree canopy and green space. It's just such an important point. And Columbus is really doing a ton of work in this space. I'd love to talk a little bit about the work that CityHealth is doing with both of your communities. So both Portland and Columbus have received a gold medal in green space. I would love to know from you both, and Todd, I would love for you to start. How do you feel that having these policies in place helps support your other park and health efforts, and really looking at the different components of this medal, which are access? I mean, that could be the 10-minute walk to a park, or it could be tree canopy, access to tree canopy, investment, really looking at how much the city is investing in your park system and your programming, and then also in equity. How are these either parks being planned and placed or supported in disinvested communities, historically disinvested communities, or where are trees also being planted and or maintained in historically disinvested communities? So Todd, would love to start with you with this one.
Sure. So I talked a little bit about our half mile for all Portlanders being within a half mile for parks and natural areas, and then our canopy goal for the 33%. So maybe I'll move on to a little bit of like, how do we pay for this in Portland? And so we've had something about a sustainable, we call it sustainable future. Our park system in Portland historically has been paid through a series of parks levies that last 5 years in the state of Oregon, and then parks bond for capital investments. We also have something called a park system development charge, which all infrastructure city departments collect. So that would be water, sewer, parks, and roads on new development that is developed in Portland. And so that fee that's paid by developers helps us acquire new parkland as our city grows. So growth pays for growth in Portland. So that's been really important for us to close those gaps as our city grows, as we move in, as we've expanded our city over time, we've been able to build more park spaces, more trails, more community gardens to serve the community. Capital side of it, we're falling behind a bit. We have a 100-year-old park system, not unlike other public infrastructure probably around the country, but we have about $2 billion worth of assets in our park system, and we have about a $600 million major maintenance backlog of where we have to do repair and replacement. So we're prepared. The last time we went for a capital bond was in 2014, and we'll be looking forward to go to back to Portland voters in the coming years to help repair and replace some of those assets. I will note that we've done some research, and it's been really important to use our specialists, whether it's GIS mapping, or collecting our census information, collecting demographic information for our community, so we know where to make those investments. That's been really important. So again, we're focusing on race, income, and youth. And for us, we've done the research now that we know about, we need to build 13 new parks in the eastern part of our city. It should cost about $300 million. And that would close our gap. So we would have 100% coverage for all Portlanders to have a park or natural area within close proximity of their house.
That's phenomenal. I am sure there are going to be questions coming back to you both about the bond and the levies, just fascinating. I also want to just note this idea of growth pays for growth, I think is also a fascinating way for cities to think about using some of those particular charges on new development to then in turn be used to both beautify and also expand access to green space within communities. Fantastic. Anita, I would love to hear your perspective on this. and maybe we can center it more specifically around the health department's goals. How has green space policies or policies related to parks and tree canopy helped advance the priorities and the goals of the health department?
Thank you, Catherine. And I really, really want to point out that with public health, you know, our whole goal is the health of the community. And that means so many different things. And I really appreciated Howie's slide that he had on what determines the health of the community. And I think some key points that we need to look at is the violence that's in our community and how that affects green space. And right now, we have really dedicated in public health division. It's our neighborhood social work division, and it centers around anti-violence prevention, as well as resiliency building in the community. And I think when we talk about health, it is resiliency. You know, I mentioned previously that we have one block at a time, which is a new pilot program that we're working on to really, you know, feed in and build resiliency in one neighborhood. And really the concept is it's one block at a time. And so, you know, all of us have to work together to have the community health, to really focus in on community health, period. And we have also have made gun violence a public health crisis, as well as racism as a public health crisis. And I think that, you know, we really need, you know, to look as a whole. I don't think there's one entity that can do it all, but green space is so very important for the mental health and resiliency of our community. If we take that away or reduce it, we're going to look at a lot of very impacted health disparities. I hope Catherine, is there additional comments that you want me to make regarding that? I think I've kind of termed our top health indicators with public health and green spaces.
Anita, I think you did a beautiful job of just talking about all the myriad of benefits that green space can potentially provide. And as Howie's slides noted, there are multiple pathways, right, that we're looking at. And as we all know, particularly in practice, this is complicated, right? And so we're teasing out all of these different particular factors and trying to address them specifically with a very well resourced and also intentional both siting and programming within parks. I really appreciate that. I'd love to switch a little bit and talk really specifically about equity. And Anita, I may ask you to go first on this one. So achieving green space equity means directing resources and support to the areas that have lacked investment and attention historically. I would love to know, particularly from the health department, how are you using data and community input to identify those specific needs and areas that historically have lacked investment in green space or tree canopy? And how is the health department thinking about addressing them?
Sure. Everything that we do here is motivated by data. You know, we're very evidence-based, so we're always constantly looking at, you know, what neighborhood, what are the hot spots, who's lacking in resources. And I don't quite remember, I think it may have been Howie mentioning redlining. And we're really taking a very serious look at redlining here in the city of Columbus. And just looking at the areas, I mean, it's almost like a complete T in our city that you look at areas that have been affected by redlining, and looking at grocery stores, access, looking at tree canopies. And again, I'm so very proud of working with our Rec and Parks leaders to really identify the areas that need more green space, need more trees. And looking at that equity lens and trying to understand that and partnering with the communities when they say that there's a need or there's a safety issue, looking at that data. But everything in health, we drive by data and by evidence-based practices.
That's great. Anita, thank you so much for that. And definitely, as you and Howie mentioned as well, the effects of redlining policies have been long felt and continue to have an impact on communities. Todd, I know we've talked a little bit about regularly hearing from residents using that input to drive action and investment on the side. of the Parks Department. I'd love to hear what that looks like in practice, and then how do you translate that feedback into action?
Sure. Well, we call it our listening and learning process. So we're on an annual cycle in Portland now of listening and learning with the community. So we have great weather in the Pacific Northwest in the summer. So we're out at cultural events. We bring together events ourselves where we serve food. And the whole point of it is to provide resources that are available through our Parks and Recreation system, the free programming, how they sign up for our access pass for the financial discount, how they learn to get a free tree from the city to plant it in their yard. A lot of different services that we offer. So it's kind of like a resource fair. But also this summer, for instance, we're focusing on like, how do people want to connect and recreate? So what does that mean for them? And so it's centering the community rather than ourselves as a government agency providing services and learning about what those experiences that they're looking for in their lives and in their neighborhoods. And oftentimes that's beyond just us. So that's where the partnership comes in, because it might be at the park or it might be at the community center, but there might be something else that they want in their recreation. And so we're trying to learn that every year, going out listening to the community. Through that, we're trying to really focus on experiences. So a park is great, but not all parks are the same. So we have some parks that have a variety of experiences. Sometimes they might have 10 different experiences, a playground, walking paths, bike parks, skate parks, but then other parks might just have one or two experiences. And so we've gone through a process of mapping those within our system. So we have kind of like a heat map of showing like where there's a lot of experiences for the community and where there's less. And so that's allowed us to basically engage with the community, hear what they want, and through the community engagement process, then use some of our growth funds, as we've described through the Park System Development Charge Fund, to add new amenities to parks, representing, you know, what we've heard from the community. So we hear from the community that they want a new skate park in that certain location, and then that's what we build.
Yeah. Super important both to hear both the breadth of the work and then also the specifics about how you all structure these sessions and then pull out the themes within those sessions and then incorporate into strategic planning. Anita, we actually have a question that came in from the Q&A from Dylan that I would love for you to address. And it says, for the work in Columbus specifically, but would love to hear from the other panelists, what are some of the evidence-based practices you have found most effective for incorporating equity into green space planning? And Anita, if this is not something, obviously you coordinate with the Parks Department within Columbus, but would love to know maybe some of the factors that you try to incorporate or even some of the practices that you all incorporate in your work.
Sure. And as I said, you know, we really do work off of data and evidence-based practices. And again, I keep talking about this one block at a time. And we did a lot of research, with that project, and it's a pilot project. And basically, you know, individuals of color are, if you look at the redlining too, are really, you know, have not had the advantages of green space. And if you look in, and Todd had mentioned kind of a hot, you know, like a map showing the different minority groups throughout Columbus. And as we looked at the neighborhoods, we really saw that, you know, why we chose that neighborhood was really the data that said they really are underserved in that neighborhood. And so I think that shows one of the evidence base is that, you know, the community at large, that the individuals of color are not given the same opportunities for the green space. And, you know, I thought about this, we launched that pilot program in, I think it was the end of October last year. And as I was walking through that neighborhood, I don't know if I saw that many trees at all. So I think that's just one indication that, you know, just to be aware, look at your data, find out where our minority, residents live and really absorb and go into those neighborhoods and provide services to them.
Mm-hmm. That's incredibly helpful, Anita. Thank you so much. And I really appreciate you lifting up the block by block example, because it's very concrete and also is very clear about where there are potentially opportunities to provide some additional resources or even some direct engagement, which is really great. Todd, is there anything that you would wanted to add to that before I ask my final question?
I think it was covered. I'll just add one of the other partners we've looked to partner with is our affordable housing developments here in Portland. And so where we can co-develop a new park with affordable housing nearby or adjacent, that's been something that we've done, actually acquired property together with the intent up front to have affordable housing nearby.
That's amazing. It's also nice to hear affordable housing and green space not being thought about as binary, right? Like you have to have one or the other. We can have both. We need to have both. So really appreciate pointing that out as well. So I just have one final question for you both. This has been such a rich conversation, and I'm reluctant to end it, but also I'm looking at the time. So Trust for Public Land's recent park score findings show that a majority of the 100 most populous cities have a formal partnership between parks departments and health institutions, such as a public health agency, like in Columbus, a hospital, health insurer, or provider. I would love to know, what do these partnerships look like in your city? And also, what big goals or challenges could a Greenspace Health partnership potentially help achieve? And for this, we'll start with you, Todd.
Sounds great. So if we're going to end on time, I'll be really quick. One of our partnerships that we have is with some private health insurance companies, of where they bring our seniors to our program, or they help fund our seniors have access to our program. So we have direct reimbursements from insurance companies that pay for seniors to participate in our programs. So that's been really exciting. And using that model, we're starting to investigate. We'd love to expand that to Medicaid recipients in our city and our county. So that's something we're working on in the future, but really excited about as a health partnership.
Fantastic idea. And Anita, we'd love to hear how you're thinking about partnerships and what this might look like in Columbus.
Well, sure. And I just mentioned Rec and Parks as one of our city departments, but Todd, you mentioned development, and our Department of Development is very involved in housing along with green space as well. But we have, you know, community organizations, we have our local hospitals, our neighborhood associations. They are all very much partners with us in doing this work to provide health to our community and green space. And then one thing I do want to note too, we've had an increase in violence in our parks. And so this is very alarming that we've been working with our Columbus Police Department and putting up more cameras to be readily available so that when individuals go to the park, they feel safe. So I really wanted to mention that has been a plus in our community.
A great reminder. And on that note, I just want to say, Todd, Anita, to everybody who has joined us today, thank you so much. This was a great conversation. To learn more, please visit cityhealth.org or tpl.org. A recording of this webinar will be available on Next City. It will also be available on CityHealth's website, as well as the Trust for Public Lands website, which you can now see on your screen. Thank you again. Have a wonderful rest of your day and enjoy the solstice.